Hello and welcome to the show. This is episode 41 of the Life of Gaming podcast. My name is Jamie and I'll be your captain on this cruise of video game awesomeness. And you might all notice tonight that we have a big empty hole on our screen where Mr. Brandt should be. But he's having some PC issues, so he is not with us tonight. You can send all your hate mail to him. It is his fault. But don't worry, we have a great crew tonight. We have someone filling in for Brandt, the puppy monkey baby of our group, if you will. My brother-in-law, Matt.
Puppy monkey baby. Puppy monkey baby.
How you doing, sir?
That was the most awkward commercial
ever.
Doing great. It's been a good couple weeks. Busy. Very busy couple weeks, but it's been good.
Awesome. Awesome. And I had to use the puppy monkey baby because if it goes any farther after this, the joke will no longer be relevant. So I just had to throw that out there.
That's true.
That was going to go in Brant's face, but since he wasn't here, I had to throw it on you. Oh, but if you guys...
want me to do like a dance on you and everything too?
Right, right. And bring me my Mountain Dew. That would be wonderful. But if you guys are watching the video, you know it's not just the two of us. We also have a very special guest back with us, Mr. Joey Ferris from Nerd Reactor and Ferris Wheel Productions. Joey, how you doing?
I'm upset because I'm single and it's almost Valentine's Day. I'm just kidding. No, I'm fine.
Well, that's good. So what do you got in the cooker, man? Anything new? Anything hot and fresh?
Oh, well, I'm three, maybe four episodes now into this new podcast I'm doing called Game and Talk, which you guys should listen to if you like this podcast. Bit of fair warning, though. This show right here that you're listening to right now is very family-friendly. The other one, mine, is not so very family-friendly. So little warning there, but it's great.
So you got to let
doing
loose.
It with Alan.
We keep you in this little box, but you need to be free.
I'm free. Like, I got Bobby from the Geekcast in there, like, about 30 minutes ago, and we were just all swearing up a storm. We were like, we're free. James can't hold us back this time. It's great.
Oh, that's great.
Every other word is a cuss word, just so you can say it.
Awesome.
Yeah, so you can check that out, soundcloud.com/gameandtalk. We're also on iTunes and Stitcher, and yeah.
Cool. Awesome. Any new videos or reviews or anything else you want to throw out there before we get the show started?
This weekend, or by the time you're listening to this, hopefully, I'll have a Rise of the Tomb Raider review, PC version review, out on nerdreactor.com and YouTube. So it'll be like my Ferris Wheel Productions review, where, you know, I get a skit in there, try to add in some humor that everybody hates, and then it's just good to go. Yeah,
awesome,
yeah.
Awesome.
You of all people.
Well, hopefully it's better than Batman on PC, because we all know how great that was.
It's much better, thankfully, so it just takes... The thing is, that thing requires a lot of... I have a really good PC, right? My graphics card is 8 gigabytes of VRAM, and that thing cannot hit 60 sometimes. So
wow. Huh.
I don't know if that's to do with poor optimization, or it's just the graphics engine is really, really demanding. So.
No, I've seen seen video of the PC version. It looks really nice. Really pretty game. So, and I loved it. On Xbox, it was awesome.
Same. It's so good.
Cool.
Well, so I still have to get to that one.
Yeah, Matt, you got to borrow that, man. It's a good game.
Get on that right now.
I'll get to it. I got Fire Emblem first, though, coming out next week.
Well, okay, let's start and talk about what we've been playing. So, Joey, since you're our guest, we'll start with you, man. Outside of Tomb Raider, anything else you've been jamming on your game consoles?
Three other games. Well, one I haven't played in a while, The Witness for the PS4,
cool.
On a PC.
Okay.
So hard. Oh, my gosh. Like, the puzzles in there are ridiculous. I'd much rather be playing Bloodborne because it's easier. Okay.
Wow.
And yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I wish Brandt was here. And then there's also Unravel, the game that just came
awesome.
On Tuesday.
Oh, yeah.
It's interesting. It's not as feelsy as I thought it was going to be, but it's I have yet to beat it, so I'll beat that one soon. That's also going to be a review on Ferris Wheel Productions, my main channel. Don't know when, because I still have a lot of other stuff to work on.
Sure.
And then I've been going back and replaying some Doom, because I'm so hyped for the new one.
Awesome.
Like the original Doom?
Yes, the original Doom.
Cool. And
I discovered that like a year and a half ago.
Wow.
And I'm like, wow, why did I not discover this sooner? This is amazing.
You know there's a sequel called Doom 2. And
yeah,
Doom 3.
I want to beat Doom 1 first.
Awesome.
I have actually beaten Doom 3, because I got the BFG edition.
Oh, cool.
There's a movie as well.
Oh, yes, with The Rock.
Let's not.
hey, that movie, I remember that movie when it came out. how amazing it was. Had the first person shooter scene in there. It's like, oh my gosh, it's just like the game. But
and that was about it.
Yep, pretty much. Although the movie wasn't terrible. It's one of those like guilty pleasures if it's on TV on the weekends kind of thing. You just sort of turn it on.
The problem was it just wasn't Doom. That was about it.
Right, yeah. Right, sure. Although, actually, speaking of first-person action movies, did you see the trailer for that, what's that called? Like, Hardcore Henry?
Hardcore Henry?
Oh, my gosh.
Yes.
Matt, so you look excited. Confused. Go watch the trailer for Hardcore Henry, because I'm watching the trailer. I'm like, it looks interesting, but I don't know if I can sit like a whole hour and a half movie like that.
Is it first person? So is it like all filmed in first person?
Yes, the
like
whole movie. All you see is like his hands out, like as he's running. You see him holding guns and stuff, and it's.
It looks like a bigger budget Freddie Wong movie.
I have no idea who that is, but I'll say yes.
Oh come on, man! He was the one who made Flower Warfare, and there are special effects people on YouTube. Just know that.
Okay, awesome.
They made a couple of live action Call of Duty short films, shot in the first person. So yeah.
Oh, awesome. So, I mean, outside of Doom and I almost called it Yarny, but Unraveled and, you know, anything else you've been playing? Hey, that's the name of the main character, man. He's Yarny.
That is. nothing much else I've been playing. I want to, I wish I didn't have so many games I have to play right now, because I just want to keep playing. I just want to go through my Steam library and see what I haven't played yet.
Sure. I've got the same problem with my Steam library, because over the winter sale, I finally have a PC that can play games. So I went crazy and just bought like a ton of stuff, and I like haven't touched most of it yet. I still have Her Story sitting on there. I've heard good things about that, and I haven't touched that
yet. I need to play that one also.
So, well, hey, Matt.
I have all the... Yeah, go ahead.
No, sorry.
Yes.
I have all the... I bought a bunch of collections, like Tom Clancy's Splinter Cell and Hitman, and I still haven't touched them, and I have them all, so weird.
Hey, the Hitman games are awesome. I love those games.
The first one sucks. It has not aged well.
That's actually very true. Very, very true. And that one you can only play with mouse and keyboard, I think, right? Like, you can't actually use a gamepad on that. Like, it's very weird.
But that's the least of its problems.
Right. Well, Matt, what have you been gaming, man? I know you said you've been busy. Haven't been able to play anything?
I have a little bit. I'm watching the Hardcore Henry trailer right now, which is pretty weird. There's this, like, awkward nurse walking around him and attaching a cyborg leg to him or something. I don't know.
Now we can tell because your audio quality is significantly lower.
Oh, so anyways, there, I paused it. So should be good. I have been playing Castle Crashers. I am. It's a relaxed night.
Sure.
No, I actually got Kelsey to create her first ever Xbox profile. So
awesome.
She actually has her own name and everything, and she's got a little pink dashboard she can go to. And I got her to play Castle Crashers and start creating a character. And, of course, she chose the little pink one with the kissy faces on it or whatever it was.
Sure.
But we're, like, probably a third of the way through the game.
Oh, wow.
And to preface this, Kelsey, other than playing Peggle and, like, Candy Crush and stuff, has never really totally enjoyed games. So I was super pumped to actually... like be able to play through a game with her, and it was simple enough for her to pick up on, and she was enjoying it. It was a good time, something fun to do together. And with her, I've also been playing Jeopardy on the Wii.
Cool.
Wheel of
classic.
Fortune. That's it.
Wheel of Fortune. Wheel of Fortune.
Another classic.
Yeah. And then as far as
Speaking of Wheel of Fortune and Jeopardy, did you know there's a clause that there are sister shows, and if you appear on one, you are by law not allowed to appear on the other one?
What?
Yes. I read that online randomly the other day, and I thought that was very strange.
There goes my dreams.
Sorry, man. Go ahead. Didn't mean to interrupt you with that.
Interesting. I've been playing Madden 16 because it went free for EA Access members.
Oh, yeah. Cool.
So I got it free, and I've been messing with that. I got like a... I took over the Rams, and then I moved to London, and I got the first ever London franchise. And like the London Bulldogs or something like that. It's a lot of fun being an owner. It's actually really cool. Other than that, a little bit of Super Metroid. I've been getting into Super Metroid, which I'll hopefully have some videos to put up. I know I've been pushing that off. I said I'd get that last summer, but finally getting around to that. So
hey, man, you have a long weekend. You have no excuses. You are off today, and you're off on Monday.
Well, I also have a lot of paperwork due to finalize my license, so to speak.
Ah, boo-hoo-hoo.
Residency program. But I am going to play a little bit.
Cool. Anything else?
Yeah. Oh, other than that, I can't really think of anything. A little bit of Pokemon X.
Oh, cool.
But that was just like falling asleep.
Pokies.
Awesome, yeah. Awesome. Pokemans. Hey, is the 20th anniversary or 25th?
It's 20th. 20th, yeah. When does the Pokemon Go come out? The one where you're downloading to your phone?
I don't think they have a date on that
yet. I don't think they have a date for it, no.
Yeah.
Although there is some, you know, Poke news. I mean, stuff's happening because Poke tournament's coming out soon. And they just had, what was that? Detective Pikachu? Is that what that's called? Out in Japan.
Yes. The Great Detective Pikachu, voiced by Danny DeVito, hopefully. Probably not.
Oh, man. But yeah, it's the year of the Pokemon, man. But anything else, man?
Oh, no, I think that's pretty much everything.
Okay, awesome. Cool. For me, talking about playing video games with our wives, as I talked about last time behind me, all my wonderful Amiibo, now I have Disney Infinity people up there.
Yes.
The other day, I went to GameStop and got in their sale, traded a bunch of stuff, and got, like, I got the Disney Infinity starter pack, which comes with Star Wars. My wife's not a big Star Wars fan. So I got the Inside Out pack as well, so we can play through that together. And I got that, and I got Sadness, a couple other figures, and it cost me like $13. So I was pretty happy about that. But since I've actually added to my collection. We got the Toy Box Takeover, where you can use pretty much any character you want and, you know, fight through different stories, which is pretty cool. Syndrome stole Merlin's wand, and he's like going through different worlds and stuff, so it's actually pretty cool. And then yesterday, we got the Toy Box Speedway, which is kind of like Mario Kart, where you can race like all your characters through different worlds. They've got courses based on like Nightmare Before Christmas and Sugar Rush from Wreck-It Ralph and things like that. It's pretty cool.
Although, so cool. I always wanted a Sugar Rush game.
Oh, yeah.
But, Sugar I mean, it's fun. We're having a good time playing that together. Other than that, nice. Fallout 4 just got patched. So I've been back into that, playing that a little bit, playing a little bit of Fallout 4.
Were you able to get through that part where it glitched?
No, actually, I started a new character before, a few weeks ago, and I think it overwrote my save file, so I'm not too worried. But I want to actually get through it to a good point when the DLC comes out, so that way I'm far enough along the story, my character's leveled up. So I've been playing Fallout 4. The other thing, Shoot Shimi, I don't know if you guys have heard of that before. It's kind of like... it's very odd. It is a shoot 'em up game where you're a goldfish, and he's got like these massive arms and hold guns, right? And like so, like you're it's kind of like a 2D like goldfish is over here, and the enemies are coming in, you know, in waves, and you're shooting them. But because you're a goldfish, you're a goldfish, he only has 10 seconds of memories at a time. So he's telling you like his great. So it's like these levels. It's like WarioWare mixed with a shoot 'em up, right? These levels are literally 10 seconds long, and you go through a level for 10 seconds. You beat it, then it goes to shop mode, and you have 10 seconds to pick out an item that which will carry into the next stage with you. And like it's crazy fast. It's fun, but I mean, I got the copy because I'm reviewing it for the work print. Well, actually, already reviewed it. So if you go to the website, you can check it out. Which I didn't review it very highly because it's a game that kind of runs out of steam pretty quick. There's only so many power-ups. With only 10 seconds, you don't really get enough time to get in the groove of a level. You just kind of like blast through it, and right when you're about to get to it, it's like, oh, it's over, and it jumps to the next stage. It's fun. It's up to 4 players. It's on Wii U and PS4, and it's okay, but I think it's a little – if it was $5, I'd say absolutely go out and buy it. But at $10, I'm like, wait for a sale. It's fun for the novelty alone because one of the power-ups, I mean, they do all sorts of crazy stuff. One of them turns the stage to a bouncy castle, so you're like bouncing around like you're hopping on enemies and stuff. Another one actually turns all the enemies into flying butts wearing sunglasses. Like, it's the whole
thing.
It's very strange. And like I said, if you could get it for $5, the novelty alone is worth it. But $10, I'd say hold off. The other thing I've been doing, the other thing I've been doing, which is kind of random, I started playing Don't Starve again on my Wii U. I absolutely love Don't Starve. I've got it on my Xbox One. I've got it on my Wii U. I played on my Wii U more, so I've got more leveled up characters and things like that in that mode. I've got more things unlocked. So every single night this week, when I get home from work, you know, my wife and I eat dinner, watch some shows. Normally she'll get on her tablet or, you know, even if she goes to bed early or something, I just hop on Don't Starve and play it for like an hour or two each night. So I've been playing Don't Starve again. That's a really good game.
I couldn't
really get into Don't Starve. Oh, yeah. Don't know why. Yeah. Sure. I don't know. I'm just not into Minecraft type things.
Right. Sure. But what were you going to say,
Jamie,
Matt?
Oh, Jamie, you forgot one. We played Assassin's Creed Unity
together. That's right. We did. We tried the co-op for the first time.
Did multiplayer for the first
time. It's actually
really
fun. Yeah. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Although you're way more powered up than I am because you finished the game and I never finished it.
Yeah, so. I pretty much like I got like a super powerful sword and armor and everything. So I was just like killing everybody in front of you as we ran.
That's okay. That's okay.
I want to beat Unity, but I don't because it's Unity. But yeah,
right.
It's just the story lost me at a certain point.
Yeah,
it ends okay, time, but you're right. Yeah.
Yeah. Now that we're gonna have more time because there's no Assassin's Creed this year.
Right.
So we have time.
Yeah. Right.
Catch out.
I still have to get into Syndicate.
Yeah, I'll let you borrow that, man. That's a really good game. Really good. But okay, guys, with that, we're going to hop into our news section in what we call Captain's Log. Okay, guys, we'll start off with our Xbox news. Everyone's kind of doing a little sway thing here for the camera, which is odd, but okay. On our Xbox news, Quantum Break. Everyone's excited for Quantum Break, right? Yes.
Yeah. So excited.
Awesome.
Remedy is 10 out of 10 developer.
Sweet.
Oh, yeah.
I'm super excited for it. They just announced a brand new bundle for Quantum Break. It's 500 gig white Xbox One. It comes with Quantum Break and Alan Wake with all DLC. So you can get all that together in one bundle, which is pretty nice. Nice. If you already have an Xbox One and you don't want the bundle, if you pre-order the game digitally through your Xbox One, you also get Alan Wake and all the DLC. So you can get that, you know, that way. If you pre-order from GameStop, an actual physical copy, you don't get Alan Wake. You get a code for American Nightmare, which is kind of like the kind of sequel spinoff.
It wasn't that good.
Right.
Yeah.
So, but one really cool thing, if you pre-order Quantum Break digitally, you also get the Windows 10 version for free.
Wow.
Boom.
That is interesting.
Yeah, you get, so if you...
Now,
yeah, sure, go ahead, man.
Then they were like, oh, did we mention there's a Windows 10 version?
It's free.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just curious. With Alan Wake, like how you would get it for free, is it just like a backwards compatible version or is it like a slightly revamped version?
Okay. Yep, backwards compatible.
If we already have it, then... Because
pop,
I already have Alan Wake
system.
And I have all the DLC. Okay, so I don't have to worry about getting the
nope.
bundle then.
Nope. Although, one thing I will say with that, American Nightmare, it is backwards compatible now, but Alan Wake isn't.
Interesting.
Which is strange. So
because Alan Wake's the better game.
Right.
Yeah.
So I don't know why.
They're probably waiting until it gets closer.
Right, because I think it's coming out in, I want to say, April? Beginning of
yes, April.
Yeah.
So that's when, so we at least know by the time Quantum Break comes out, Alan Wake will be backwards compatible.
Now, okay. I just got to say, if you don't have an Xbox One yet, you got to get on this because Alan Wake is incredible.
It's a great game.
Yes.
I love that game so much. I've been
one
clamoring
of the best
for
games
a sequel.
Of last gen.
Now, have you guys watched the live-action Quantum Break trailer they just released?
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
I did. The one where they hinted at Alan Wake? Because there was one that they released in December.
Oh, no. There's a brand new one where he's in a graveyard.
Okay.
It's like a scene from the game and like FBI or not FBI or SWAT team. Someone's like, you know, coming up behind him and he freezes time. It's actually pretty cool. Check it out.
Oh, nice.
It's actually the same. It's all one long video where the first like few minutes of the video is where they announce all this stuff. And then they show the live action trailer part after that. It's on Xbox's YouTube page. You know, check it out. On PlayStation side of things, they're doing the vote for the free games for the month again. So last time they did that, I think was December, I think.
Yeah, I think it was.
I mean, it's been a while.
Like Grow Home, right?
Right. This time they're going to have three different games. The options are Assault Android Cactus. And it says Assault Android Cactus is a fast paced, tightly tuned shoot 'em up that plays like a modern day arcade. And also Action Hank, which is a fast-paced running, jumping, and butt-sliding platformer.
My favorite, butt-sliding.
Butt-sliding, yes. Or Bro Force.
That always says, makes a good
Bro
game.
Force fights terror in the name of freedom through the use of excessive force to blast liberty into terrorists.
Now, the best part about Bro Force, I haven't played it, but I watched a lot of things about it. You're basically playing as literal parodies of 80s action movie stars.
Wonderful.
Nice.
Like, they're not called that. They're like, I forget, there's like Snake Bliskin or something. Something stupid, but it's clearly Snake Plissken.
Right.
So, and they don't even hide that. And currently that game is leading the poll because I voted.
Awesome. And is that what you voted for then?
That is what I voted
awesome.
For.
Now, I can't remember. You only get one vote, right? You can't go back and vote multiple times?
One vote.
Okay, cool. Okay. Awesome. So
I knew some games that they need to bring back, or at least make backwards compatible. The Death Spank games.
Oh, yeah. Those were really good. I forgot about those. You ever play those, Joey?
No, I haven't.
There were three of them, right?
Yeah, there was like the original one, Death Spank 2, and then The Baconing.
Which was, the third one.
Yeah, they were all super
fun. What kind of names are these?
Yeah.
They're very, it's that corny humor. Did Double Fine make those?
I don't know if they did.
Because it's the same kind of humor as Double Fine games.
Yeah, because you like hunt down, you attack chickens and unicorns, and like it's like a top-down kind of adventure game. Not totally top-down. It was kind of behind you a little bit.
Right.
But it was an adventure game, and you just built up Death Spank, and you were trying to get the thongs. I think the second one was the thongs of virtue.
The thongs of virtue.
Yeah, all the different thongs.
Joey, you would love it, man. Check it out.
Yeah,
Xbox,
it was
I love it already.
Yeah.
Oh, those are good games. But, on to Nintendo news. We're actually speaking of Pokemon earlier. Just one quick news flash. Next Splatfest has been announced. And it is going to be Pokemon Red versus Blue. Which version do you like better? Obviously, I'm going for Red because it's the better version.
Oh, Blue. Blue.
But, that's just me.
What about you, Joey? Red or Blue?
Not a fan of Pokemon, and I haven't played Splatoon in months.
Oh, wow.
I know what's wrong with me. I'm such a traitorous Nintendo fan.
When you turn on Splatoon next time, all these things are just going to start downloading to your system.
That's what it's the longer I wait, the worse it's going to get.
Just get in. It's worth it. Get back in there.
Yeah, I want to get in there. That's one of the games I want to go back to play when I'm done with all these other games.
Awesome. Yeah, and that's one we could just, it's just easy to go, as long as the crowd's still there to play it.
Absolutely.
Which I think it'll be there for a little while. Kind of like Mario Kart, there was a decent crowd for a while.
But the big news with Nintendo within the last couple weeks, they had their financial briefing recently where they announced, how they're doing
finances.
Things. And it was the first time they really talked to the new president. And he came out and said a few interesting things. I'm just going to pull out. There's so much. I mean, it was pages and pages and pages of information. But I'm just going to pull out some key notes here. The first thing he mentioned, 3DS will continue to be a major pillar for them. But they didn't say much about the Wii U. Just to quote him real quick, he said, "We presented a number of titles today that show what kind of software can drive our business. We've not yet announced all of the Nintendo 3DS software for the fiscal year, but we are proceeding with development, including major titles. The Nintendo 3DS will continue to be a major pillar of our business in the coming fiscal year." They went on to say, the 3DS has sold over 54 million units, but it would have been possible to sell even more software if all 54 million systems were in frequent use. So they know people are buying these 3DSs, and they're probably just upgrading and getting rid of the old ones. Like, it's probably not 54 million constant players.
Yeah.
He said they've got two ways to approach that. He said, one, release software that make people want to play, or two, create an environment where people around you are playing. So I'm not really sure how they're going to do that. But he said they feel
NX.
Those are the two ways. Well, this is just 3DS, though. This
I know,
is just
3DS. I wouldn't be surprised, though, if they built some sort of connectivity in the way that, PlayStation did the Vita to the PS4.
Sure. Sure. And pretty much he went on and on and on about the 3DS. When they asked him about the Wii U, he said one thing. He said, as for Wii U, we have just passed 10 million units worldwide, so it's not quite on the same level as the Nintendo 3DS.
That's
he said,
cool.
We received a great response for titles such as Splatoon and Super Mario Maker. We would like to continue to release titles. We expect to be received positively. That's all he said. Mm. So Wii U, when even Nintendo themselves aren't talking about Wii U...
Well, it was also a financial meeting, and everybody knows it's kind of a failure, so you don't really want to acknowledge that overwhelmingly when you're trying to prove to your investors that
But hey,
you're succeeding.
Still think NX is coming out in 2017? I don't think so.
everything is leaning toward 2016. But the other interesting thing, just two more points here. He said that what they want to do, they want to start focusing more on the younger staff. They want to bring them to the spotlight. He said, when I became president, I stated that my role was to continue to proceed on course that I helped to set with President Iwata and the rest of the management at that time. The ideas of our young employees are key to our ability to transition to the next generation and to continue to produce exciting ideas. It is important to structure our organization so that these young people can take active roles. So it seems like they're really starting to shift They want to bring in that young audience. Hopefully that means Nintendo will finally get their online structure set properly. They'll start having more, you know, like an online infrastructure that will work.
Splatoon's a great start.
Right.
I mean, great online infrastructure developed by a younger studio. Mm-hmm. Nothing but success, and I'm loving it.
Right, and it's a brand new IP. And I think if they really focus on these young people to bring out new ideas and they trust them to run with it, I think they'll be fine.
Mario Maker was also run by a younger person, too, believe it or not.
Really?
That's what I've heard. Yeah.
Really?
Awesome.
It wasn't his idea, but he was the one leading the development, I believe.
See, that's what I'm considering picking up. Like, I've only played it, like, on a few times, but because I don't actually own it. But every time I played it, it's been a lot of fun. There's always a lot of pretty cool levels on there.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, the only time I played Mario Maker is when we did the Extra Life back in November. That's the only time I played it. It's a game
which half the fun is putting on the amiibos on and then turning into those characters.
Which they keep adding more characters. Like, it's crazy how many characters they have in that game. But yeah. The only other thing, they said that NX and mobile is where the future growth for Nintendo is going to be. He said the previous and current fiscal years have been a period of preparation to launch a number of new endeavors, such as NX development, developed for smart devices, and business using our character IP. That's where they see the future of Nintendo. So, I mean, I was listening to another podcast today. I can't remember which one it was. And they were talking about Nintendo, you know, going mobile and being on smartphones and, you know, what games are going to use. Because Nintendo came out and said, we know Miitomo's coming. We know that's coming. We don't know what else they're bringing. But they said their second game is going to be on a well-known IP. And I was listening to another podcast today, and they said, well, what about WarioWare? And I was thinking, that would actually be really smart for smartphones.
That's perfect right there, see?
If they would do that, because the last WarioWare game they had was Game & Wario for Wii U, which really wasn't that great. But if they went back to, like, WarioWare Inc. or WarioWare Twisted or Smooth Moves or something like that, where it's just a fast-paced boom, 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 here's a bunch of mini-games.
Man, the WarioWare for the Wii. Smooth Moves, right?
Yes, Smooth Moves for the Wii.
Oh, God, that was incredible. I sweated. That was a workout.
Man, WarioWare has always been awesome, and I think it'll be smart to put on smartphones. I mean, that's just, it fits. It would fit perfectly.
Absolutely.
For Joey,
What was that?
Oh, I was gonna say, are there any other ideas you think for an IP, a popular IP? Because I really don't think they're just gonna do like a Mario Runner. I don't see Nintendo going that route.
Man, you know, when you said well known IP, it's like, how could you not put F-Zero on there? Oh. I'm just kidding, but man, something like I can't. That's the thing about Nintendo. It's like you can't give them ideas because they're going to blow them out of the water and right. come up with something unique. Who would have saw Miitomo coming?
Yeah. We still don't know what it is.
This is true. Well, so, yeah, I don't know.
Sure. Matt, do you have any idea what kind of IP they could possibly fit into a smartphone that they already have?
Man, I'm trying to think. I would love to see a new Professor Layton game, but that's level 5.
Oh. Actually, they did already do a Professor Layton game on iPhone.
Yeah, that's right.
It was like the Professor Layton Brothers or something like that. It wasn't like exactly tied into the games we know, but it used Professor Layton name.
Like every game I can think of, though, I feel like the only way I can imagine it is in some sort of adventure style, and I feel like the games they're going to put on smart devices are more towards the Candy Crush-like type of games where it's like quick, puzzly kind of things.
Sure.
So like I was thinking like you could do a side-scrolling Metroid where you just like push to like move your character in that direction and stuff and then shoot at whatever you tap and stuff. But like that'd be too – I think they realize that wouldn't sell very well. So I don't know. Like whatever they do, they're going to do it like
Metroid
puzzly.
Sells well.
That's
that's true.
Man, look at all the hate that Federation Force gets. It's not even out yet.
I'm actually super pumped for that game. That game looks fun.
So am I. I want Metroid in my life, and I want it now.
It's been a while. I mean, what was the last Metroid game?
2010. Other M.
Oh, wow. What a sour note. Like
such a sour note.
The gameplay is actually pretty good. It's just the story is like...
It's all right. Yeah. It's all right. Sure. The story blows.
Well, okay, to get out of our Nintendo stuff here, real quick to touch on some third-party stuff. Joe, you had mentioned it earlier. Assassin's Creed is officially not coming out this year. It's the first year in a long time. And Ubisoft said that they're going to take the year to re-examine the franchise. Now, pretty much all I think that means, they already have to have a game in the works. It's probably almost done, and they're just doing like some testing and just ironing some bugs out.
Those are going to be some pretty heavy bugs to iron out.
Right. Well, yeah. Look at Unity, more like... man. Look at Unity.
Exactly. This is true.
Either that or they just want to take a year off so everybody can go see the Assassin's Creed movie.
Is that this year?
Yes, December. It is December.
Oh, wow. Awesome. Michael Fassbender.
Cool. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, the best. If they can do what they did with Prince of Persia, the movie, like that, when I watched that, I was like, it kind of felt like an Assassin's, because the way he'd be on top of the towers and like spin around, and like, it totally looked like an Assassin's Creed movie.
Assassin's Creed was an inspiration. The Prince of Persia was a huge inspiration for Assassin's Creed.
Very true.
I just think the first Assassin's Creed game was meant to be a Prince of Persia game, but then they like rebranded it.
Got it.
Yeah, and I was disappointed in the Prince of Persia movie because it was nothing like the Sands of Time story, which was an awesome story, one of the best video game stories ever, and they just totally changed it.
You're still bitter about that, huh?
I am. It's still kind of an enjoyable movie, but it's like, it's the movie is as close to the Prince of Persia Sands of Time game as like the Resident Evil movies are to the games.
Sure. Sure, but... what Resident Evil did was kind of smart, though, because they kind of made their own story just for the movies. And it's the most popular video game movie series, and it just keeps going. I mean, I think they're filming the last one now, or is it already out? I can't even remember.
They're filming it now, yeah.
Yeah, so. Well, the only...
They had, like, two injuries on set so far.
Oh, jeez.
No, one injury that required amputation.
Oh, jeez.
And
oh,
another
goodness.
That killed someone.
Oh, wow.
So
what?
Sounds like a good movie, huh?
Oh, yeah.
My gosh. They'd stop making
I really
those.
Hope the... Yeah.
Oh, the, man. The,
plus, the, what you I do when you get
around
zombies.
The final chapter is not going to be the final chapter.
Yeah.
But the only other third-party news I had, they announced officially LEGO Star Wars The Force Awakens. It's going to be coming out in May. It's coming out for pretty much every system. And they said it's going to reveal where C-3PO's red arm came from. It's going to have its own little story.
Finally.
I know. The story everybody wants to know.
The one detail that everybody wanted from that movie.
Seriously, what was the point of that?
Right. Well, Matt.
Did they just,
being a Star Wars fan and being a LEGO fan.
Yep.
Will you be checking out LEGO Star Wars The Force Awakens?
Not right away. I just got LEGO Star Wars The Complete Saga again, and I'm kind of going through that. And I got LEGO Dimensions, so my LEGO fix is kind of filled. The Force Awakens I saw a few times in theaters, and it was awesome. I really enjoyed it, but that's kind of filled right now. I think like later on down the road, but I almost feel like you got The Complete Saga where you play through all six of the original films, and then all of a sudden you have one game for one movie. And I'm like, I feel like there's not as much story there, or not as much to do, but I don't know.
Sure. What about you, Joey? Do you play LEGO games at all? No.
Last one I played was Jurassic World, which is good, but I was like,
sure.
They're still really fantastic games, but I'm kind of burned on them.
Sure, right.
And they just came out with LEGO The Avengers, so.
Oh, one weird thing the LEGO games are doing now, how they're, instead of getting voice actors to come in and record stuff, they're pulling the voices like right out of the movies.
That's so weird.
It looks weird. It sounds weird. Like I don't like it. I don't like it at all.
See, I preferred it originally when like with the Star Wars original one collection where they didn't have any voices. They just all did facial expressions and they like fell and stuff. That was funny.
Now, wasn't Lord of the Rings LEGO the first one that had voice acting? I think.
Yeah. And I think they pretty much just took it from the movies. Like you said.
I don't know if that part's true. I don't remember. But they definitely did that for The Hobbit. And they did some of it for Jurassic World. It was a bit of both.
Oh, okay.
Like for some characters that weren't important, they filled them with new lines. And I even think they got Chris Pratt in to do some lines for the Jurassic World portion. And and the new LEGO The Avengers, I think it's all purely original voice acting too.
Cool.
Like, I know Greg Miller got the role of Aldrich Killian. I forget his name.
I did see
the
that.
The bad guy in Iron Man 3. I was like, whoa, that's weird.
It's pretty cool, though. Now, the only thing I'm wondering, though, with this new LEGO Star Wars game is how they're going to handle... I mean, there's some... I don't want to spoil anything for people that haven't seen it, so I'm not going to come out and say it, but there's a pretty big scene toward the end of the movie. What are they going to, how are they going to, I mean, it's a very big scene.
The movie's made $2 billion. I'm pretty sure everybody who's wanted to see it has seen it by now.
Yeah, let's just say a big thing happens at the end on a catwalk over a giant hole. Yeah. You know.
End of what movie again?
Star Wars, The Force Awakens.
Oh, yeah.
That. Right. So I'm just wondering how they're going to handle that in a Lego form. We'll see.
They'll probably just get pushed. I don't know.
they'll add humor to it somehow. It'll be interesting. But
he'll swipe him in half, and then the legs will do a little walk and fall out from him. And he'll look at him and be like, oh.
My 7-year-old brother cried his eyes out during that part.
Wow.
From what I heard. Huh. I wasn't there when he saw it, but yeah.
Well, before I move on to the My Two Cents money-saving section, any other news stories you guys want to hit real quick?
Oh, I feel like there was something. Oh, Titanfall 2 is going to have a single-player mode
confirmed. I forgot. That's right.
And that he aims to put it in, the writer, Jesse Stern, known for his work on Call of Duty 4, and it's one of the best shooter campaigns ever made. He wants to make a world that's where science meets magic, and it's grounded and dirty and human and stuff. Mm. Yeah. And it should come out near the beginning of 2017 or the end of this year, they said.
Cool. Is it confirmed multi-plat?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep, it's going to be on everything. It's going to be on, I think it's on, what, Xbox One, PS4, and PC, I think?
Yes. Wii U?
CC. Hi.
Oh, you're
probably NX.
Guy. Yeah, maybe. Here's the thing I'm wondering. When NX comes out, if it really is as powerful as they say it is it going to start getting these multi-plats? I mean, I'm just curious.
I still don't think so.
You never know.
Depends on how many units it sells.
Yeah.
See, Nintendo's in a position where they could have a system that's twice as powerful as the PS4, but then everybody's going to be like, well, we're not going to make games for it until they sell systems. And they'll sell 10 million units and they'll be like, we're still not going to make games for it. Whereas when the Xbox and PlayStation first came out, there was just this, oh, well, we know they're going to sell, so.
Yeah. A lot of bitterness from Matt tonight.
Yes. Well, I love my Nintendo. I'm sad that people don't like it.
Right, and I agree. We'll see. I read a really interesting article today. I can't remember who wrote it. And it was talking about how Xbox is starting to take more ideas from Nintendo versus PlayStation, the way they're handling their stuff, where they're not really going, because of where they're at this generation, they're not really going after trying to be the most units sold. They're going after establishing franchises and trying to get exclusive, make more first-party exclusive stuff. So we'll see. It was really interesting to read. But, okay, we'll hop into our money-saving section, My Two Cents. Let's let you guys know where you can save some dimes here and there. For the Xbox, right now on Amazon, you can get the Gears of War bundle with an Xbox One for only $300. That's not too bad. Or if you want to do what they're calling build your own bundle for an Xbox One, it is $350. But you also get a $30 gift card with that. So it's it's $20 more. So if you really want to choose a game, the games you could choose from, Forza 6, Rare Replay, or Rise of the Tomb Raider. So honestly, of those games, I'd say get Rise of the Tomb Raider if you want to do it that way. Not too bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially since Rare Replay is only 30 still.
Right, it's still super cheap, and it's a great bundle. It really is. I mean, the Rare Replay is a whole package. It's awesome.
So good.
But another bundle choice outside of Amazon, on Microsoft's website, if you buy a bundle, Xbox One bundle, any bundle, you get the choice of Watch Dogs or Assassin's Creed Unity for free, and they also give you a $75 gift card. So pretty much anywhere you go to get an Xbox, you're going to get some kind of, gift card. On the PlayStation side of things, right now at Walmart, if you want to get a PS4, you can get the Uncharted Collection bundle, which also comes with 1 year of PlayStation Plus for $350. It's not too bad. And PlayStation Network right now is holding a Ubisoft sale. Some of the games on there, Trials Fusion for $10, Toy Soldiers War Chest for $10, you can get Rainbow Six Siege for $40. There's some other Ubisoft games on there as well. So go on PlayStation Network. I don't know, Joey, have you been on, seen any of those sales on there right now?
I haven't seen a lot of them. I haven't really been on my consoles lately because I'm still playing the PC, Rise of the Tomb Raider.
Sure. Okay.
Is Rainbow Six Siege, is that the one where they made a big deal about how you shoot through the walls and stuff?
Yeah, and it's multiplayer only. Yeah. See, yeah. And that's one of I have a lot of friends playing that right now, but it's hard for like just having time to meet up with everybody to play it online. It's just I just don't have time to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, outside of Splatoon, I don't really play a lot of multiplayer only games. But for Nintendo, we actually have something for Nintendo, believe it or not. Amazon, right now, you can get a black new 3DS XL for $180. So if you want to upgrade, not bad. I mean, really, the processing power, how much faster it is than the old one, and the eye tracking for the 3D is so much better. If you don't have a 3DS right now, go for the new 3DS. Plus certain games, like Hyrule Warriors Legends that's coming out, they say if you don't, even though it plays on all systems, if you play it on the old 3DS, apparently it runs like garbage. There's a lot of pop in. The frame rate drops in half. Like, it's just, it's a mess.
I don't understand why they want to put that on the handheld to begin with.
Yeah. I mean, and that's one where I'm on the edge of double dipping for that because I love it on Wii U. And if I get it on 3DS, I get all those characters. Plus, there's two new stories in it because, of course, they have Linkle in there. And you also have a Wind Waker story in there, too. So it adds more content. So I'm like, new characters and new content, $40. Plus, I can get it over to my Wii U. So I don't know.
Mm-hmm. But do you think they're just doing you think they're just doing that, like, with the Xenoblade and the Hyrule Warriors because there's, like, 50-something million 3DSs that have been sold and not Wii U so that, like, more people can get to experience those games?
That plays a huge factor in it, yeah.
Sure. Yeah. But and one thing, they should make more exclusive new 3DS games. The only ones they have right now, I think Binding of Isaac and Xenoblade Chronicles, the original, are the only new 3DS exclusives. And from the way I hear Hyrule Warriors runs on the 3DS, they should have made that a new exclusive too. But like you said, Matt, with 54 million units out there, and most of them are old 3DSs, not the new ones, they want to sell as many copies as possible. So
yeah.
They need to give people a reason to want to buy the new 3DS, and they haven't done that.
Have either of you guys got a chance to try the Legend of Zelda Triforce Heroes?
No.
Yet?
No. I heard it was... My friend's a huge Zelda fan, and he labeled it the worst game of 2015.
Really?
Wow.
He's just a little upset, but yeah. It's not the worst, but it's just... I just like single-player games, and it doesn't cater to my kind of demographic.
Sure.
Gotcha, yeah.
And I know, Matt, you're more of a handheld, top-down Zelda kind of guy, aren't you? Versus the 3D.
Oh, yeah. I loved Link Between Worlds, and Link to the Past is probably my favorite of all the Zeldas I've played, which is like 10 of the 14 or something.
Cool. Yeah, for me, I've tried to get into the handheld ones, and I love the 3D ones. So, you know, Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask and, you know, in Twilight Princess and Skyward Sword and all those. I love those. And I've sat down and tried to play the top-down handheld ones many times. I just can't. I normally get like halfway through them or three-fourths of the way through them, and I just stop. Which sounds terrible, but I don't know. They just don't click with me. But, okay, to get on some game sales right now, if you don't want to get a console but you want to add some more content to what you already have, right now on Amazon, there's a whole lot of stuff going on Amazon right now. Life is Strange, awesome game. If you do not have it, pick it up. If you get the physical copy on Amazon, you get a free $10 gift card from Amazon. So it's already a cheaper title anyway, so check that out. Deadpool, the movie came out. Joey, I think you said you already saw it, right?
No, I'm seeing it on Sunday,
okay,
actually.
Okay, cool. But the game, if you want to play the game, they have it on sale on Amazon, $25. So it's kind of cheap right now.
The game is good. It's good.
Not great.
That's about it. It's not great. Is it funny? But if you like Deadpool, it's funny, yeah. It's way more of the wacky Deadpool than like the snarky one in the movie.
Okay, sure. So if people see the movie and they want to play the game, they'll probably be disappointed.
I don't know. We'll find out.
Sure.
It's very rare that you actually have a game based off a movie that actually is really, really good.
Very true.
It's not that it's even based on the movie. I mean, the game came first.
Yeah.
So.
The game came out like beginning of last year.
It came out like 2013, actually.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, really. It was a while ago.
But the other games we got here on Amazon sale, Batman Arkham Knight, you can get it for $26. Here's one, Guitar Hero Live, the Wii U version. It's normally $100. Hmm. You can get it on sale for $40.
That came out for Wii U?
With the guitar?
Yep, controller and everything.
Nice.
The whole package. $40 on Wii U. I'm assuming because the Wii U version, like you, Matt, most people probably didn't realize it even came out on Wii U. I was actually considering that one because I'm like, it's cheaper. I mean, I can get back to playing the guitar games because the Rock Band bundles, just with the guitar, start like $120.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people forgot Guitar Hero Live came out, to be honest.
Because, I mean, if you look at review scores and stuff, Rock Band scored way better than Guitar Hero Live did.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people forgot about Rock Band, too. I thought it was going to be a comeback when I heard about it, but no, not really. I'm sorry.
Right.
Yeah. I think it's just that style of music isn't as popular as it was 8 years ago.
Right. More like the style of game, but
like band music, or yeah.
Yep. I mean, it was at every party. Everywhere we went, people want to play Guitar Hero and play Rock Band, and now it's just like, not there. But also on Amazon, Wonderful 101, more Wii U love there. You can get it for $28. $28.
Ooh, I might have to get that.
Great game, man. If you haven't played it yet, check it out. At Best Buy, speaking of Star Wars Battlefront, you can get for $40. Speaking of Disney Infinity, like we talked about earlier, the Disney Infinity Starter Pack, which comes with Star Wars, Twilight of the Republic, you can get that for only $50. And also, Rise of the Tomb Raider Best Buy is only $40 right now. Not too bad. So those are all amazing games we've already talked about today, so check all those out.
And speaking of Star Wars Battlefront, it's a double experience point weekend.
Awesome.
So, yeah, will those points go towards my season pass? No? Okay, I'm not interested. I have a huge vendetta against that game. That doesn't reflect the opinions of Life of Gaming Podcast, so everybody chill out.
Oh, thank you for putting that disclaimer in.
Yeah.
But, okay, guys, any other gaming deals you know about going on right now this week?
Nope.
Okay. With that...
What are the Xbox games of the month? You might have already said that, but I...
I did not have that in front of me.
Oh, no.
I can't remember.
Better figure it out, man. Clock's a ticking.
I know, man. It was like Sticks, I think, was one of them. And then, man, I can't remember. I know on PlayStation it was Nom Nom Galaxy and, man, I can't remember. I've got like one of each in my head and I can't remember what they are. See, man, you threw me off. You just ruined the show.
Good job.
Because it happened 2 weeks ago, so I didn't even think about putting it on my list.
Yeah.
So that's the problem with going back to bi-weekly for now. We get busy and so we're going back to bi-weekly and I miss some news stories. But, okay, with that, it is Valentine's Day weekend, so... You know, grab the one you love and give them a nice big smooch because we're going to be talking about our favorite video game couples and romances this week for our topic of the week. So without Brant here, Matt, is up to you. Hit it, sir. All right.
Boo, 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 boo.
Okay, that's enough. Thank you, sir. I don't know if that's going to get Brant's stamp of approval, but, you know, we'll let it slide.
Probably not.
We'll let it slide.
He can't say anything. He's not here.
Right. Well, what we're going to do this week, being Valentine's Day, we're going to talk about our favorite couples in video games. And then we're also going to be talking about different games that allow romancing in them. And, you know, which choices we made and things like that. But one thing I'm going to kick it off with. What I consider one of the very first video game relationships. And that would be Mario and Princess Peach. Now, actually, though, if you go back a little bit, before he had Princess Peach, Mario thought he was a cool, slick guy. And he's like, I'm going to go by Jumpman. That's going to be my cool name. I'm going to be called Jumpman. And he went out with a woman named Pauline.
Brooklyn accent. Don't forget that Brooklyn accent.
And he went out with a woman named Pauline. And then she got kidnapped by a giant ape. And he saved her. And then the next game, he kidnapped that ape and tried to torture the ape's son and Donkey Kong Jr. It gets all kind of messy. But after that, he he reformed.
What
he became
monster.
A new man, and he got with Princess Peach. And even though we know not, I mean, there it's very ambiguous relationship, he always tries to save her.
I know, right? It's like, what does he get in return? Jeez.
He gets cake. And then every once in a while...
Oh, I get the cake. I risk my life many a times. And then I get this stupid cake.
He gets the cake, and every once in a while he gets a kiss on the nose. So, I mean, absolutely worth it.
That big freaking tumor of a nose.
But, okay, we'll move on from there. What do you guys, what are some, like, couples in video games that have kind of, you know, made the impact or they're very memorable? Joey, you said you had a great list for us. Hit us with it. Name someone.
These are These are all Sonic relationships. Keep that in mind.
Perfect. Perfect.
All right. Now, there's Sonic and Amy, which isn't really a couple, as more like Amy is a very, how do I call it? She's the psychotic creepy girlfriend down the street who's like, Sonic, hi. And then he's like, Amy, gotta go fast. Something like that. I don't know.
Well, he's always eating chili dogs, man. That's what he does.
Yeah, I know, right? They didn't even bring up the chili dogs until like Sonic Generations in video games. It's weird.
But they're always in the cartoon. Like, was Steve Urkel. Steve Urkel is the voice.
Jaleel White.
Well, before we hit another one, Matt, what do you got for us, man? What is a couple that really stands out to you in video games?
Oh, like a couple. Probably the... Oh, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, we had one. You said, oh, that's an awesome one.
Yeah. My probably hands down, the one that always stood out to me is Prince from the Prince of Persia and Pharaoh. Like the way... Because basically that entire game, there's three humans alive the entire time. It's the bad dude, and then you and Pharaoh. And you go through the whole game together and go on this awesome journey. So that one was always like a really cool story.
So, and why, I mean, what made you connect with that? I mean, what made you think that they were meant to be?
Oh, well, just like the whole way it plays out. Like, they hate each other at first. She sees him as like a spoiled brat, and he sees her as just kind of like a, you know, just a girl doesn't really need to be cared about, who's getting into things she can't handle. And they spend all that time together, and then, like, I don't know, plays really well. It's kind of like the same feel as like Cloud and Tifa, the way that, you know, you just go on that journey together and then, you know, eventually builds together. And I know Cloud and Tifa had like a history apparently when they were kids, but yeah.
Sure. Cool. What I have on my list, where originally I wasn't going to bring it up, because most of the time they're not really in a relationship. It's the hero and the princess, and that is Link and Zelda. Because most of the time, they're never together. I mean, you never see them together. They never have feelings for each other. They're just, like, he just knows he has to save her. It's his destiny to save her. But the thing that made me add them to my list is Skyward Sword. If you played Skyward Sword, they're together, like, from their children and the relationship they build, and you feel, like, the love tension between them. Like, it just, you care more for Zelda in that game than I've ever cared for Zelda in a Legend of Zelda.
I know,
game.
Right? She has a personality. What the heck?
I know. It's crazy. But what's going
to
happen?
I haven't got to that one yet.
What's going to happen when they start giving characters voice acting? Then we're going to have a problem.
Oh, come on. We're going to have a whole episode dedicated to this. There needs to be voice acting. I swear.
Oh, man. Well, Joey, what do you got, man? Who else? Who else stands out in your mind? As a couple that will stand the test of time.
Okay. Buckle up, because it's about to get real up in here. Okay. Big the Cat and Froggy.
Wow.
Froggy, where are you? There's nothing that can keep those two apart. Not even a big body of water that he's staying in. Froggy just got a fish, just bring him back. He got possessed by a weird water creature and everything, and one of these days, we will see Big the Cat's return in Sonic, and it'll be incredible.
Now, wasn't Big the Cat in Sega All-Star Racing? The
I
first
think
one?
He was. I don't remember.
Yeah, he was. He was on that bike. Geez.
I remember. Oh, my gosh, dude.
He would be on a bike, I swear.
I remember playing Sonic Adventures when I got my Dreamcast. Now, Matt, you played on a GameCube, right?
Sonic Adventure?
Yeah.
I played never on a GameCube.
Played him. Really? I thought you played them. Okay. Because I had them on my Dreamcast. And I just, those games, I remember when you play, there's certain characters when you get to play them in the game, you're like, oh, I got to be this character again. Big the Cat was one of those characters.
Like, he's come like, on. Oh, dang it. I got to play as him now.
He's slow. And I can't remember what, did you fished with him, right? Wasn't that like what you
That's
did?
That's all you
yeah.
did.
It's like, oh my gosh. Well, thank you for bringing up those horrible, horrible memories.
You're welcome. Anything for you.
Oh, man. Well, Matt, what else do you have for us, sir?
Oh, man, I'm trying to think. Because... Actually, you're right. Like, a lot of times it's just hero has to rescue somebody.
Right. But one where the relationship actually matters.
I guess, like, with Uncharted, there's Nathan Drake and Elena.
Sure.
which, you know, they kind of got that on again, off again thing. Always adventuring after the same prize and always running into each other.
No, so in 4, they're going to be married?
Yes.
They are?
Okay, because they've kind of hinted at maybe they're married, maybe they're not married. But I agree, Matt. They've always had a really good relationship. I kind of feel that number two, I think was number two where they had like, it was number one, number two, they were really good. But like number three, she was kind of wasn't really in it, if I remember right. It's been a while since I played.
She was, but like it's like he randomly tracked her down so that she could help get him a flight somewhere, and then she dropped him off the airport and just let him go. No.
Right. So, I mean, you got to keep that relationship building. I don't know, why would they do that? It's like, you have this great relationship. Let's just let it go.
Eh.
Sure. But, okay, let me grab another one here. I've got one, but it might be weird because I don't think they're related, but I'm going to name one that it's kind of cheating, but it's kind of not. But I'm going to talk about someone where if you want trouble, they'll make it double. And that is Jesse and James in Pokemon. Team Rocket.
They are not related, actually, so you're good. Because if you remember,
but they're
Jesse...
not a couple either.
Oh, come on.
I don't know.
Hey, if you can use Big the Cat and Froggy, I'm just saying.
Yeah, okay, fine. You win. You win this round.
Thank you.
But I'll be back.
Team Rocket is blasting off again, man.
It's funny as I was literally, my next one was going to be the other one within that universe.
Well, go for it, man. What do you got?
Ash and Misty, man.
Okay.
There's a lot of tension there. I can feel it.
But they're never actually together, are they?
Between those two children.
Yeah, Matt, you're getting kind of creepy, man.
Hey, I was 10 when I first played it, so hey.
Right, sure.
And okay. Ash is still 10, so.
He's like Bart Simpson, man. He never ages.
Didn't they have like a thing lately about how he's changed or whatever, or what changes they're making to him?
No, the voice actor. That's about it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. They're like, hey, he looks a little bit... Maybe one day they'll give him a beard. Just like Joey, like Ash of a nice, thick beard. To show he's aged.
Eat your heart out, right. Josh Brandt.
Oh, man. Well, Joey, since we skipped you and jumped to Matt, what else you got for us, man?
Okay, this is the realest one.
The real deal, okay.
Okay, and you guys played this... There's a little masterpiece of a game called Sonic the Hedgehog that came out in 2006... And in it was the relationship between him and the human Elise. And it was the most beautiful thing I have ever seen in my entire life. There was a part of the game where, spoiler alert, Sonic dies. She cries. They gather the Chaos Emeralds. And she, like, kisses him right on the mouth. And then he turns into Super Sonic. It was a beautiful thing. I've never been more proud to be a Sonic fan in my life. I'm going to cry now.
Wow, that sounds absolutely atrocious.
Because it is.
Oh, my gosh.
It was so bad, guys.
Human on hedgehog action sounds kind of creepy, man.
It was so bad. Oh, my God. But, yeah, that was it.
Oh, man, dude, that is hilarious. I did not know about that because I totally forgot that game. That was on 360 and PS3, right?
Yes.
I totally forgot that came out because there was like a gap in there. I just stopped playing Sonic games.
Horrible game.
And I started playing
probably
them.
A good gap.
I started playing them again at Sonic Generations. Sonic Generations was a really good game because I didn't play Sonic and the Black Knight and Sonic and the Secret Rings or like, oh, they had all in Sonic and the Werewolf.
I played Sonic and the Secret Rings. Wasn't too bad for a Wii game.
Yep.
It was all right.
Sonic has had a lot of bad games. Like, really, like I'm looking back on it, I'm like, man. Now, Lost World wasn't bad. I know, Matt, you really like Lost World a lot.
I really like that one. Especially the Zelda level and the Yoshi level that was downloadable.
That's weird. I know.
About that. Although, if you download Sonic Lost World on PC, there is a mod you can download where it puts Mario in the game instead of Sonic. And, like, it switches. Yeah, it's actually, look it up. It's actually really cool because Mario's, like, running really fast. And everything's been changed because the enemy is Bowser and, like, your partner is Luigi. And when you're, like, snowboarding down, like, hills and stuff, the snowboard says Mario on it. Yeah, dude, it's crazy. Look it up. It looks awesome.
Mo, PC community, what will you do next?
You never know, man. You never know. Oh, man, let's see. What else haven't I hit on? Oh, I know one I can do. Because if I don't say this one, my wife would probably get mad. And that is, I'm going back to Nintendo, Luigi and Daisy. Because yep. Daisy originally was the princess in Super Mario Land on the Game Boy.
Yeah.
And Mario, you're still Mario. You rescue her. And then what? Mario just kicks her to the curb. Hey, not good enough. You can go to my brother. Just kicks her to the curb. What happens? Because after that, they've always kind of linked Daisy and Luigi together because, like, it's a princess. Luigi needs somebody. It's very strange.
Poor Luigi.
It's very strange. And
it's not as good as Toad and Toadette.
Right, right. Although, with Daisy, it's kind of funny because she'll just be in random places, like in golf for the NES. Daisy was Luigi's caddy, I think. Like, it's really strange. Although they make Daisy, somehow Daisy became like this tomboyish girl. And I guess that makes sense to put her with Luigi, who's kind of like the wimpy, you know, quiet guy. So that, I think you could tell who's dominant in that relationship.
Wow.
Yeah.
I guess that was a thing.
There you go.
That happened.
Right, right. But, okay, Joey, hit us with another one, man. What do you got?
Okay, you guys brought this up earlier, but who in Gears of War 2, Dom and his wife, who was his wife?
Maria,
yeah. Yes. Yeah. That was realist when, spoiler alert, if you haven't played Gears of War 2, he's going after her this entire game, finds her, she's, like, on the verge of death. So then he has to kill her. And right. I was just like, wow. That was really sad.
Great Valentine's
and
Day.
Like, yeah, Jeff. Yeah. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody. Hope you don't wind up like Dom and his waifu. Yeah.
Oh, man. And Dom really went through a great character arc, I feel like. I mean, because he's with Marcus, and they were great, and they were buds. You know, they were bros, right?
Yeah,
and then,
they were
but
bros.
The second game, they wanted to give him more, I don't know, more character, but just... give him more of an identity, really. And they came up with the whole Maria thing. And the funny thing with the Maria thing, though, in the whole game they're talking about her like, you already knew about her. But really, we didn't.
Yeah. They're like, oh, crap, we got to mention the first game. Well, maybe they'll catch on.
Right, right. Although...
he had kids, too, and they were dead, which was even darker.
Yeah, I know. Oh, man, that it takes a really dark turn. Because they say his kids died on... But not D-Day? Not... They don't call it D-Day either. What do they call it?
No, it's Emergence Day.
That's right. E-Day. Right. Yeah, his kids died, and then his wife got captured, and he never found her until that part in the story. But I can't remember. Here's going to be a major spoiler for those who don't play Gears of War. Dom, when does he run the truck or whatever into the...
Third one.
It's the third one. Okay. So he does survive till... Okay. Cool.
Yeah,
but
man,
Dom's
like,
story, he's just all messed up from his wife.
He is.
Talk about
I would
love,
be messed up,
man.
Too, if that happened to my wife and kids. Jeez.
Oh, man. Well, real quick, I just want to grab another one talking about sadness. Dead Space. Isaac Clarke and his girlfriend, Nicole. You're playing through this. He's looking for Nicole, and you can't find her. And you kind of hear her talking to you, leading you through things, and you're like, okay, I'm going to find her. And then, but if you pay attention to the names of the chapters of the game as you go through, it actually spells out the word... Nicole is dead. But you don't know
what?
That.
I didn't know that.
Go back and check it out. Go back and check it out. So the whole game, you think you're searching for Nicole and you're searching for the artifact, but the whole time they're just messing with your head. It's all mind games, man.
Yeah.
But that he cared about her so much, he went through all that to save her.
I need to replay Dead Space.
Relationship, that right there.
And then you saw what happened to him in the end.
Right.
Actually, I never played 3, so I don't know what happened to him in the end.
The funny thing is, I never played 3 either.
Not a lot of people played 3. 3 was very, like, from what I've heard, just it was very derivative of the formula. It was it focused more on it being a shooter than, like,
right.
a horror game.
Kind of like what happened to Resident Evil.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Nothing.
Well, Matt, what do you got? You got another one for us, man?
I do have another one that just came to mind, which I believe is going to be classic for a long time.
Okay.
I believe we're going to have... It's a new game.
Ooh, okay.
But I feel like there's going to be sequels coming out. It's going to be... remembered for a long time, and it is Shovel Knight and the Night Girl.
Oh, Shield Knight.
Shield Knight. Knight, yes.
That's
yes.
actually, I didn't think of that one. That's actually a really good one. I love that.
Like, because the whole time he's looking for her, right? And she turned right. into the evil...
Spoiler.
Yep, spoiler, yeah. yeah, and so but then he beats her, and then I think they're good after that point, right? I've only...
We
think
so.
They're good.
They good. Now, originally, I remember when the Kickstarter came out, one of the Kickstarter goals was to make Shield Knight playable. I don't know if that's still in the cards or not, because I know we got Plague Knight DLC, and we're still going to get King Knight DLC, and we're going to get Spectre Knight DLC. All of that stuff is still coming for free, but I haven't heard anything on Shield Knight.
Maybe for Shovel Knight 2, it'll be two playable characters. You could choose between Shovel Knight and Shield Knight, maybe?
Yeah.
Or maybe super, different levels.
Super Shovel Knight is what they're calling it.
That'd be awesome. If they actually do that, and they make, they keep going up like graphically, like that would be awesome. That would just blow my mind.
That's what they're doing. Like, then they're going to do Shovel Knight 64, and it's going to be great.
That would be amazing. Awesome. That would be so good. Oh my gosh. You're blowing my mind, man. Although, actually, speaking of Shovel Knight, Matt, I've got that Shovel Knight amiibo, and I unlock, the challenge modes and things like that. But it unlocks two-player. I haven't done that. You have to come over. We're going to have to play co-op.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Thanks for the invite.
Steve, you can come all the way over. You can just fly over. It'll be fine.
You got it.
Okay, we'll do one more here. One more to go through. Let's see here. What is a good one?
Like, there's a lot of couples, but they're always, like, tragic. Like, somebody's going back to their lost princess or something.
I got one that's tragic, but it's good.
Okay, what you got?
Oh, man, I forgot her name, but she was in The Last of Us, and it was Ellie's friend in the Left Behind DLC.
Oh, okay.
And they had, like, a little crush thing going on. They, like, kissed each other right before they died, and, well, after she died, not Ellie, but the other friend. I'm going to look up who it is because I thought that was really cool how they pulled that off, because we've only heard stories about how Ellie and her friend or lover, whatever, they're kids. They're not supposed to be in love. And then they stuff happened. It was a good thing. Left Behind was a cool DLC.
Cool. I actually never got to play Left Behind because I played through Last of Us. And then I got my Xbox One, and I, sold all my PS3 stuff.
Okay. And it's Ellie and Riley.
Okay. Yeah,
Riley is her name. Cool. So they snuck out. They went to an abandoned mall, and they had, a day to themselves. And that was pretty much what the whole thing was about. It was flashback and flash forward to the present, where Ellie is trying to help Joel, heal him, get healed, and that kind of thing.
Okay.
So it was a really neat DLC. I played it on the PS4 version of The Last of Us. So,
cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, Matt, what do you got? Because I know there's another one where at the beginning you're like, I don't know if that's a couple or not. Do you want to go with that, or what do you got for us?
Master Chief and Cortana?
Yep, it's confirmed.
I think it would count. Big the Cat and Froggy. If that counts, I'm just saying.
Definitely they have some sort of emotional connection, but I still think it's weird. But
hey, if Sonic could be with a real person,
that's true.
Come on, man.
I'm just saying.
Bestiality is a thing. Have you ever played the Halo 4?
Matt? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so the end. It's totally she's in love with him.
Right.
Yeah, but she's still alive though somewhere, because in 5
I haven't played it, man. 5 sucked. I'm sorry. I couldn't beat it.
But the thing with Halo, even though you don't really think of it as a relationship, like you said, Matt, it's your AI and it's more of your companion. But the way they make Cortana, they make you feel about this relationship.
Yeah.
I mean, they give you such strong feeling between these two characters. And that's one interesting thing that, video games do, I think, completely better than any other medium. But because you're interacting with it and what you do actually matters, you feel like you're fighting for this person. You feel like you have some involvement. You have some attachment to these characters.
Especially in the games where there are choices, like BioWare games.
Right. And we'll get to that here in just a second.
Segway.
Right, that's a good segue. But real quick, I'm going to say one more. I'll do a goofy one real quick. Just to end it. A great couple. Popo and Nana from the Ice Climbers. Because in Smash Brothers, they cannot be separated. But if they are separated, then you're a mess. You just fall apart. And that's
if
how
they
relationships...
get separated, the Popo gets PTSD and he chokes on pills before
But think about it, guys. I mean, if you know, you lose your significant other, you just fall apart. That is love right there. That's what I'm saying. But Matt, to go off your segue, one other thing we wanted to hit today with all this love and romance in the air, and you can see all the little hearts, you know, above Joey's head, right? But one other thing in video games, outside of just couples that they already have set in stone, a lot of games give you the choice to romance somebody. You know, Fallout and Dragon Age, Mass Effect, all these games do that. Is there any particular relationship you can think of where, like, you worked really hard for this relationship or you just really, you know, remember that connection? Matt, I know you say you had one. Where do you want to start, sir?
Well, I mean, it's kind of one that a lot of people picked, but in Mass Effect, Shepard and Ashley.
Okay.
Like, the whole first game, I built up that relationship. And then the second game, I screwed it up because I had a romance with Miranda. And then when I got to the third game, Ashley's all like, so what about this Miranda girl, huh? And then, like, you had to, like, smooth talk her in conversation and, like, totally reject Miranda in order to stay with Ashley all the way to the end.
Good job, man.
I romanced Liara at the very end, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's her name, right? Liara?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Now, for me, see, I had a female shepherd, so the relationship that mattered to me most, it didn't really allow you to do it until the second game, but I had to go for Garrus. Garrus was always on my team, so it was actually kind of cool, because he's like this you know, hardened war guy who doesn't show emotion, and over time, you kind of like peel back the layers, and you get to know him more, and it was actually really cool. Garrus was actually a pretty cool character to get to know.
Garrus's voice actor was in Fallout 4.
Really?
Yes. Every time you go to the railroad, that messenger is always like, somebody wants to see you. That's him.
Really?
Like, if you pay attention and just listen to the NPCs talk, you'll pick out Garrus. He sounds
that
like Garrus.
That is hilarious.
So.
I'm going to hear that. Because now I'm playing Fallout 4 again. Totally going to hear that.
Speaking of Fallout 4, everybody and their mother tries to romance Piper, and I did do that, and it's just like, it's not worth it at the end. It's just like, when every time you go to sleep, you get like lover's embrace perk, and you're like a little happier or something.
Yeah.
I don't know. Huh. I don't know.
Oh, another one I just thought of. Joey, have you ever played Fable, the original?
Nope. Sorry.
Okay.
I hasn't.
I was gonna say,
hit us with it, man.
Fable,
what you got?
It's not so much an actual character. In Fable, which, you know, it came out forever ago. It was like 04, 05, somewhere in there. You could actually, like, go up to random women, and then if you talked to them enough or flirted with them enough, then their, like, a little heart would appear above their head, and it would get bigger. And then you could offer them a ring, and they would marry you. And then as long as you, like, you bought a house in that town, they would go live there. Well, you could buy houses in different towns, so you could get married to, like, five different people and have a different wife in each town.
Wow. Like, wow.
You see, if I did that, I would I would get kicked out of the club. But you know, video games, you can do anything.
That, dude, I didn't know that. That's hilarious, dude.
I remember that. That was.
Now, I know they just made Fable 2 and Fable 3 backwards compatible, but Fable 1 is not backwards compatible yet.
Well, it's because Fable 1 was for the original Xbox, but they need to make the anniversary one backwards compatible.
Got it.
Because that was the best Fable. Like, 2 was eh. And 3, I've heard is terrible, but I haven't played it yet.
Cool. Well, okay, let me ask you guys a new question. In these games where you have to have a relationship and you know, find someone you're going to have a relationship with, what is the deciding factor? Is it the perks you're going to get? Is it, you know, you like to have them on your team? Is it, you know, what makes you lean toward a certain character? Joey, let's start with you, man. I'm just curious.
Okay. Douchey got a booty. No, it would. I judge those type of things based on like their qualities, because I'm not shallow. I'm not a shallow person. I gotta like know who their mother is, their relationship with their father, that kind of thing.
Sure.
I'm just thinking of The Witcher 3, and you basically had like Geralt had two women he had to choose from, basically, in that one. They're both witches, sorceresses, however you want to call it, Triss and Yennefer. And I always chose Yennefer because she seems to have more of a dynamic history with Geralt. Meanwhile, Triss was just like, I guess she was there. I don't know. I had like a different, I haven't really played the first two Witchers, which they are both in, but I don't know. I just always liked Yennefer more because She was, I don't want to say she was older, because I feel like witches are just hecka old. They just disguise themselves to look young.
Sure, sure.
So, I don't know.
Okay.
That's just my thing.
Sure. Well, Matt, what about you, man? What is the deciding factor for you, man?
Honestly, it's like how central that character is to the storyline, like the main storyline.
Okay.
Like, the reason I chose Ashley is because she's like the one main human you start with from the beginning. And they usually make, like, in any type of those games, they usually make that particular person, like you. Like, Ashley was a human, whereas, like, a bunch of other people were not. Or,
sure.
You know, in Mass Effect or in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, it was Bastila,
yeah,
the Jedi that you had to be, like, you know, you romance her, which I think in that one there was more limited choices. I think you really could only romance her. But, like, yeah, so basically whoever is the most central to the story and kind of like is built to be the one that's close to you.
Okay.
So you
just go for the one where you think, okay, this is the one I'm supposed to go for. And that's
they're usually the most like Joey made a joke about like, do they got a booty? They're usually the best looking ones too. Like as far as character models and stuff
too.
So.
Coincidence, I think.
Yeah.
For me, I don't always go for the main character. Like I said, Mass Effect, you know, go for Garrus. He's kind of like a main character. But most of the time, I do, like Joey, I do a little research. I talk to him a lot. I get to know them a little bit more. And then I just go with my gut. Like, okay, that's where I'm going. Like, you know, I go that way. Because really,
ask
in these games.
For permission. Yeah.
Right, right. And once in these kind of games, once you go so far into the relationship, there's no backing out. Like, you haven't actually made the official connection yet, but you've done so many missions, or you've gone so far in the story, you can't change it now. So,
see, the
you
one
can't
that,
jump relationships.
Yeah, the one that always messed up with me was in Final Fantasy VII, which I still never, like, beat the entire thing, but I made it, like, really far both times I played it. There's Tifa, and then there's the girl, like, starts with an
Aerith.
Aerith, yeah. I always liked Aerith, so I kept going for her, but she always, like, died or something. I forget what happened to her.
Well, she always dies. She gets killed by Sephiroth.
Okay, yeah. So that always angered me. So then finally, I think the second time, I just went for Tifa.
That
but
game
I
came out
like,
for
I always liked Tifa more, because it's like they have a backstory, and you can't knock the back. When you meet Aerith, she's, Cloud's like, hey, sup? You got that flower dough? Okay. Forgive me, listeners. I'm from California.
That is quite all right.
We talk like this. No, we don't. I don't talk like
everybody
this.
Walking down the street in California talks like that. That's what Joey tells us, so that's what we believe.
Yes. You'll never know.
Oh, man. Okay, guys. Before we wrap up this topic of the week on love and romance, is there anything else you want to add to this topic before we tie it off? A nice pretty bow?
If she don't got a booty... Do what you will with that information.
Oh my gosh. Okay, and on that note, we will end our topic of the week. Well, hopefully you guys have enjoyed the show. Don't forget, if you're listening to the audio version, which you can find on iTunes and SoundCloud, we also do a video version now on YouTube. So make sure to subscribe to our YouTube page. You can just see our beautiful faces. Although it might break your monitor. If it does, I'm sorry. You know, burn that image into your brain. You know, that's up to you. But Joey, let people remind them, where can they find you? All your content and on Twitter and all those places.
You can find my video content on youtube.com/Ferris Wheel Productions. You may also occasionally find it on youtube.com/Nerd Reactor. So be sure to subscribe to both outlets for the best quality entertainment your subscription feed will ever lay its eyes on. You can also find me on Twitter at Ferris Wheel Pro, Instagram under the same handle at Ferris Wheel Pro, and you can listen to my new podcast, Game and Talk, with my buddy Alan. We just had Bobby Pauls of the Geekcast on, so that episode's up. Find it on soundcloud.com/gameandtalk. You can also find it on iTunes and Stitcher. And keep in mind, the Game and Talk, the and in it, is that, what's it called? Like, when you hit Shift-7? Anyone? Okay.
Yeah, well, what's that called? It? No, it's the and sign, whatever.
It's the and sign. Yeah, let's call that. It's the and sign, ladies and gentlemen.
That works. Okay, cool.
I forget the name
awesome.
For it.
Well, as for Life of Gaming, like I said before, you guys can find us on iTunes and SoundCloud, Microsoft MP3 Store. Check out our YouTube page. Subscribe on there. Also find us on Facebook. We're on Twitter, at Life of Gaming Pod. You can also find me on Twitter, at JamesPlus12. I'm also on Xbox, Jamester0722. It's the same on Wii U as well. And
I just
Matt,
want you all to know that we'll also be having... If Brandt gets his PC fixed by then, that you guys will be on our next episode of Game and Talk if all plans out.
Awesome.
This is the first time they've heard of this. No, I'm just
kidding. Well, hopefully Brandt will be back. As you guys know, Brandt's PC died. He's actually working on getting a new PC. He's actually getting a decent mic. He's getting a new mic and new webcam and all that stuff together. So now he'll actually be ready to roll. No more, you know, horrible picture version of Brandt or anything like that. You'll actually see him, so that'll be good. You can find him pretty much everywhere, Twitter, PlayStation, everywhere, at minus the Brandt. But Matt, what about you, man? Before you fall asleep, where can people find you?
Yes. Twitter, at cpunkrock07, and Life of Gaming, I'm in there too. And then Xbox is xmightymat14x. And by the way, I think like 4 or 5 people had tried to add me in the last 3 months. I just saw those friend requests like the other day. So I do add you, just maybe not right away.
Matt does not pay attention.
Yeah.
But
that's
well,
a true statement.
Thanks, man. Really appreciative of what you do. But Joey, thanks for coming on the show tonight. Hopefully you had good time talking about love, romance, and the video game world.
Anything to get away from my real life lack of romance, guys?
The Sonic relationships, you know.
That's right.
I know.
You always have Big the Cat. So you are good, sir. With that, guys, we are out of here. Hopefully you had a great time. So with that, guys, we are out.
Later.
Bye-bye.